All right. So
at PAX, the most recent PAX.
Well, I think the story actually begins before that.
So you want to begin at the very beginning.
Yes. So back when I was, you know, a kid, I played Magic the Gathering, right? In middle school mostly. And I realized, man, this is stupid. It's all this collectible crap. I hate it. You know, and I sort of got over the collectible crap in college once and for all, thanks to that MechWarrior miniature crap, right? Which is a big mistake. And I realized, yeah, collectible games are crap. But the thing is, Magic the Gathering, if it were not collectible, could be a pretty good game. And but the thing is, all the games like that were collectible. And I said, man, wouldn't it be cool if there was some sort of customizable card game that was not collectible? And I waited for this game to come along. More recently, someone said, hey, the game has come along. It's called Dominion. And I said, oh, wow, it's come along. And then I saw on Board Game Geek, this game Dominion just rose through the charts. And I'm like, oh, look at that. I'll have to get my hands on some of that.
Yep. So we had the opportunity to, you know, we're at a con.
We're at Anime Boston.
Yep. We grab in. We're like, let's learn how to play it. So we read through the rules and we're looking at this deck. And Scott, like, he finished reading the rules. He's like, this looks kind of shitty. So I'm like, all right. So I read through the rules.
It's like, you know, we were in Anime Boston. We didn't have a lot of time to really sit and be quiet and careful and really try it, you know. So I sort of read the rules, and they were kind of bleh. And I was like, I don't know if this is a good game. I don't, you know, is this one of those, you know, mistakes? Like, everyone loves Ra, you know, but it's like way up on Board Game Geek, but we know it's just the Egyptian slot machine.
Yep. Or Twilight Struggle, which is a pretty good game, but it takes so much investment, it's almost not worth it. And Battlelore, which is just shit. I'm sorry. That game is terrible.
Yeah, there's a lot of games that are way high in Board Game Geek that are not good, just, you know, but
granted,
they're popular.
The Board Game Geek top 10 is still mostly rock solid.
So I didn't pass Final Judgment on Dominion, but I wasn't going to play it, you know, like rush out to play it. I sort of was like lukewarm on it. I wasn't in a rush to check it out anymore because I read the rules.
Oh, wow. Someone calculated that with the current set of Dominion out there, it is impossible for any human to ever play every possible combination.
Sweet. We'll explain that in a little bit. So
yes, but, you know, we basically, going through this game, we decided it looked like a crappy game, and we were like, all right, forget this. We just forgot about it.
So PAX West.
Everyone's playing it.
Everyone is playing Dominion. Even Gabe mentioned Dominion.
The people.
You would walk around looking at board gaming, and just Dominion was by far. It was like Dominion and Agricola, I think, were the most played games.
Like walking out of the gaming area, like, and then around and upstairs to the room to do our last panel, I saw five separate games of this game going on at the same time.
Another very
places.
Popular game was that sushi game, but I think there were only a couple sets of it, but I think they were in constant use.
Yeah, Jared was really, like, we were both looking at that, and we didn't have time to play it, but we were
interested.
I'll
have to look that up on Board Game Geek after the show. Yeah. Anyway, so Dominion was being played like crazy, and our friend, awesome friend Ro, well, she got the Dominion set, and they knew how to play, so that's perfect. You know, nothing better than being at a convention and someone else showing you how to play, so you don't have to, you know, read the instructions and waste precious convention time. So she showed us how to play, and we were like, oh, we were wrong. This game is the shit. And you know what? The game is the shit. That's pretty much all there is to it. End of the show.
It's basically, it's cool because what it is it's a drafting kind of game where, like, you'll construct a deck and play with the deck. But instead of making your deck ahead of time or following some, like, rule for making your deck, the deck is made in the course of playing. And you're making the deck every round with your actions. Like, you play your money and you get your stuff and you put them in your discard deck and you keep reshuffling. So it's not just making the optimal deck. It's making the optimal deck as you go, because the final optimal deck, you might not be able to make that deck, because to get to that final optimal state along the way, you'll have every suboptimal deck.
Yeah, it's like in the beginning of the game, you have, what, $7 and 3 points, right? Points don't do anything, but you want points in your deck because that's how you win. That's the only thing that matters, is getting point cards in your deck, but they don't do anything. So if you just fill your deck with point cards, basically, like, let's say you do nothing but buy point cards, right? Okay, so you can't really afford very expensive ones because you only draw 5 cards at a time. So the best case scenario, you draw $5, you get a duchy, right? So now you've got four points and $7. Then you got 5 points and $7. Then, right, eventually you're going to just be drawing a fistful of useless points. Meanwhile, someone else who didn't buy points right away is getting lots of money and other stuff. And then later in the game, when they have tons of money, they buy even more points in fewer cards. They buy like the 6-point cards. That is just one card worth 6 points. You see how it's all about the proportions of things in your deck? Like when you make a Magic the Gathering deck, it's like, how many land do I put in and how many other cards do I put in, right? What's the proportion that you got to have so that you won't, you know, draw no land right away, and you'll draw enough land as you're going that you'll always have some. You know, it's that kind of thinking, only throughout the course of a game. Early in the game, you got to get more monies, and then you got to build up a machine of cards that work together in a combo, and you keep reshuffling your deck and drawing the same cards over and over again as the proportions change, and you make your deck more efficient and more efficient, and then you fill it up with point cards, and then the game's over.
Well, let's go with all the novel mechanics. I mean, one, there's this whole, you know, victory points. The only way to win is with them. But as you pull them into your deck, you're like diluting your deck.
Yep.
So it's a very subtle and nice catch-up mechanism. But at the same time, you have almost the St. Petersburg situation where it's a game of whoever switches from money action to victory point first wins, unless they switch too soon, in which case they lose.
Yep.
And you've got this mechanic where every round you draw 5 cards, and you might draw more or do other stuff in the course of your turn. But no matter what, at the end of every turn, you've discarded everything and you draw 5 new cards. That is huge. I mean, every card game like this, from San Juan, Magic, and everything, you're always in the situation where you draw a card, you can't play right away, you want it, so you hold onto it in your hand. Or you're in the situation where you have 2 cards in your hand and you want to play one, but you want to save one, and yours in the situations where, like, there are cool things you could do, but you're held back and you never feel like you really bust out with your whole hand.
Yeah, this is like, you don't, it's not so much on your turn about, like, deciding what to do with your hand, right? There's very rarely is it actually a difficult decision of what to do with your hand. You generally just lay out all your cards and you do the maximum you can do with those 5 cards. And the real decision is, what do you buy with the money that you have? And if you somehow, you know, in the rare occasion where you can't play all your action cards, which ones do you play? And then you throw everything out and draw 5 more cards. So, you know, there's a little bit less decision-making going on there, but the decision of what to buy is ludicrously important, as you will figure out if you play the game. So the other thing about this game, right, is that you buy this first of all, I want to say, Dominion won the Spiel des Jahres, which is like guaranteed awesome game.
Yep, so duh, just buy it.
Duh, right? So there are 2 sets, Dominion and Dominion Intrigue. And they're both full sets, which means you don't need the other set to play, right? You can play just Dominion Intrigue or just Dominion. But you can also mix them together because it's the same game, just different cards, right? Whatever, you can mix them up. They're coming out with Dominion Seaside, I think they're calling it. Seaport, I don't know.
I have this feeling they're going to be like tons and tons of expansions forever for this game.
Yeah, that's fine. With the Dominion Seaside, you're going to need to either have Dominion or Dominion Intrigue to play with the Seaside one. But anyway, that's not out yet. The way it works is there's some cards that you use in every game. You always use the money and the victory cards, and you always use the curses, even though they might not come into play. But the rest of the cards, right, you pick 10, and that's what you play with, right? There's a lot more than 10 types of cards in the Dominion box. So every time you play, the game is different. You know, you're picking 10 different cards to play with every time. Imagine if, like, you decide to play Magic the Gathering and, you know, you pick 10 magic cards, you know, say, I don't know, 10 different creatures, and that was all you played with that whole game, and, you know, and that was it. No other cards came into it. That's what it's like. And every time you play Dominion, you pick 10 different ones. And if you mix together the Intrigue and the Dominion, there are so many different possible 10-card combinations.
Someone calculated on Board Game Geek, it is impossible for any human in their entire life to spend the entire life playing multiple simultaneous games of Dominion to play every possible combination.
And they're coming out with more cards, so that exponentially increases the possible combinations that you could play.
Now, so the cool thing is,
the replay value is insane.
It's also, since it's simple, you know, these 10 cards, you lay them out from the boxes. If you find a really good set, It's kind of like a free cell. You can say like, oh, play with these 10 and get all your friends to play the same set again.
In the instruction book, it says, you know, if it's your first time playing, play with these 10 cards, you know, and it's actually a pretty good suggestion. And they also have like themed sets.
A lot of people are naming their sets like the Demusculator or the Demolisher or the Destructor.
Yeah, it's like play with these 10. Like, and the thing is, depending on which 10 cards you get, the game can be drastically different. For example, we played a game at PAX where there are all sorts of nasty curse cards like the Witch.
Oh my god, the witch basically proves to anyone in the world that everyone in the world is an asshole and given half a chance would destroy the world.
Right, so what happened in that game, right, is everyone had really, really low scores and tons of curses. My final score was -1.
And the game took forever, and everyone rushed the witch, of course. Yep. In fact, we ran out of curses, like, right away.
The game, right? But another game we played, like, we played a game with the beginner set, and basically everyone got a ton of points and a ton of cards, and the game was relatively quick. And, you know, the game was completely different with 10 different cards. We just played a game just now before the show, right? Where basically, you know, it was there weren't any cards out that were worth $5. There were only cards that most of the cards were worth $4. And the only things that were worth $6 were the gold and the adventurer. So it was like I kept getting $5. And then we bought all the duchies, which were $5. And basically, you know, the game just dragged out and out and out and out, and I wasn't able to keep up, and I didn't get enough victory point cards.
One problem I've noticed, the game is good. It's not great in that it's no Puerto Rico or T&E.
No, it's not a Puerto Rico or T&E. Not at all.
A lot of people on Board Game Geek are talking about all these really, like, intense strategies, and people, like, arguing about the different strategies for different loadouts. But I've found that pretty much there's only one real strategy, and you only deviate from this if you very specifically must. Build a machine probabilistically, that will generate money, $8 a round to buy provinces. Buy provinces to run out the deck. Only deviate if someone else is going to buy more provinces than you.
Yep.
And that's the whole game. That's the whole strategy, and it works perfectly. And I've never found any evidence that anything else is a good idea.
I think there might be a better idea if, you know, somehow there you find some way to generate, like, more points. You know, and maybe in a future set, right, there will be better cards than the province?
Well, no, it depends more on what sets are out there. Like, the real decisions you're making are, when do you buy militia versus some other attack card? Do you even bother with attack cards?
Yep.
Like, do you bother with militia in a many-player game when other people might be militiaing everyone? What do you care?
Yep. It's that kind of thing.
It's a good game, though. I mean, the thing is, don't think, it's kind of like Agricola. The game of Agricola is not optimizing your farm. That's the obvious trivial problem. Anyone with half a brain, like, if you're good at the game, your farm is perfectly optimal 100%. You know exactly what to do. In Dominion, if you even have half a brain and you're good at board games, you'll know exactly what to do with every hand. You won't even think about it. The whole game is figuring out what to do with all the ancillary actions on your way to the provinces to prevent other people from getting the provinces.
Nah.
Just like in Agricola, all you're really trying to do is prevent other people from getting the resources they need to get more people in their family.
Yep. But yeah, what's really
novice
great...
Novice players won't see that, yeah. So if you see that, you'll beat them.
There's a lot of... I could give a lot of Dominion strategies. Maybe we will. But the thing that's really great about Dominion is, okay, it's not as great as a T&E or a Puerto Rico, you know, from a game perspective. You know, it's not some masterpiece. It's just really great. So why play it? Well, the reason is, number one, it's really fast. You can just whip it out and play it, and the setup is pretty easy. And if you've set it up already, you can play a whole bunch of games very quickly. You know, because you won't have to reset up a lot of the games. You just have to pick 10 new cards, and you're good to go. And it's just shuffle, draw, go. It's so quick. You know, other games, like, have a lot of setup, lots of pieces, right? It's just cards. They're well-organized in the box. You can just whip them out and play.
Actually, the cool thing about it is that, especially if you're playing with, you know, a bunch of really skilled gamers, one, I'd recommend learning how to shuffle cards. And you might laugh. It's not easy. As many people who played with us,
like, I didn't even think about it because I've been shuffling cards since I was young. But there's, like, multiple people that we've played with, you know, because I don't want any of them to feel bad because we played with a lot of people. They just can't shuffle cards,
which is understandable. It's not an easy skill, and you have to learn it. It's not intuitive.
Yeah, I only know it because it's like I sort of take it for granted. But I only can do it really well because I've been doing it since I was 3. Most people go to, like, you know, card dealing school to become, like, casino dealers, you know, to learn it later in life if they don't know it already.
Yeah. But that aside, like, if you've got a bunch of people who are, like, dexterous with their hands and with cards. They're used to playing card games. You, like, there's such a visceral and active feeling playing the game. Because you, like, you draw five cards, you throw them all down, you do all this stuff, you grab them all, you discard everything, you throw it back out
like,
on the
I
table.
Can literally take my turn in, like, 2 seconds. If four Scott Rubens were playing Dominion, it'd be like, turn, you know, it'd be like, it'd be insane.
But it makes this vibe where you're all, like, every round, you're constantly picking up cards, throwing cards down, tossing cards around. It's a really lively game. But yet, as a result, it's a very, like, social game, much more so than many other games we play.
Yep. It's also...
I mean, I'm not socializing when we're playing T&E on my turn. I'm going,
Yeah. It's also a game that works really well with 2, 3, 4 players, and if you have two sets, you know, if you have Dominion and Dominion Intrigue, I think you can play with 5 or 6 players.
I want to make the Dominion Tank Police expansion.
Yeah, I know, right? That's the joke that we always make. Let's play Tank Police. All right. Tank Police! Now, the one thing is I think the cards that are in the regular Dominion set are just a lot better than the ones in the Intrigue set.
I agree.
The Intrigue set is more sort of like these slightly weird cards. They're a lot more dickish. You know, they do a lot more funky, weird stuff and a lot less of the simple and straightforward stuff. And, you know, that stuff can be cool, but it's like too much of it. It just sort of makes the game a little finicky and flaky. You know, but, you know, Intrigue's still good. It's good to have more Dominion. If you just had the only, you know, just the Dominion set, it eventually would get kind of stale. And you need the Intrigue set to spice it up. And I think that's why I'm going to get the Seaside set, to spice it up even more. Thing is, if you haven't played it at all yet, I would recommend just getting the plain old Dominion and starting with that. And don't get the Intrigue set till you're bored with the regular one.
But just make, you know, actually learn the game. Don't just read the rules and go, actually, you know, play it. If possible, get someone to teach you how to play it who knows how to play already.
Yeah.
That'll make it go so much faster.
Yeah.
There are some minor gripes, though. One, copper, silver, and gold are all the same color.
Yeah, that's annoying.
That bothers a lot of people.
Another thing that bothers me is you look at like a copper, right? And it has the number, a copper is worth $1, right? But it costs $0. At the top, it has 2 ones in the corners and a big one in the middle and a 0 in the bottom left. And it's sort of like, you know, you could have made it look a little different, maybe. You know, so I keep looking. I'm like, oh, this costs 1. Oh, no, wait, no, it doesn't. It costs 0, you know? Some of the other problems I have is basically this $7 problem, which I'm pretty sure is intentional. But basically, nothing is worth $7 in the game.
Well, the way to get around that is to get a buy action and then buy like a 5 and a 2.
It's true. But sometimes there is no way to get a buy. I mean, the game we just played, there were no extra buys whatsoever.
Well, it depends on what kind of game you're playing. I mean, every combination is different. And you have to... Every different combination will have these ruts where, like, that amount of money is a suboptimal amount of money to have in your hand.
I know. It's like, you know, if everything on the table is either $4, $6, or $8, and you draw $5, it's like, I wasted a whole dollar. You know, there's nothing I can do with it. I drew $7. Fuck, if I only had one more, I could get the $8 card much better. Like, eternally frustrating. You just keep drawing $7 every turn, and all you want is $8 so you can get the province.
One problem with the game is that having it in the boxes kind of sucks, but there aren't really a lot of good ways to handle this game because you need to keep all the sets separate and easy to get to.
I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to get, you know, the long boxes that, like, baseball card guys put cards in, the kind I have under my bed from when I was a kid. And I'm just going to put little pieces of paper between...
Don't use paper, pieces of paper. Use actual, like, cardboard dividers with the tab at the top.
We can use whatever, but, you know, the point is just I'll just put them all in the box in one row so it takes up a lot less space than the gigantic Dominion box, but then I'll put little, you know, dividers in of some kind.
What I really don't get, though, is a lot of people are buying sleeves for every one of these individual cards because they're worried about the game, like, wearing out. Seriously, for the pain in the ass that is and the cost, just buy the game again like 5 years from now.
Yeah, I know, right? The other thing is that, you know, what does that really protect you from? It protects you from maybe a spill, right? If someone spills something
all
over
your game. Here's one worry that
I see. The thing is, right, no one spilled anything over any outboard games.
Scott, no, the worry is that, all right, as more expansions come out, the expansion cards will be obviously expansion cards because they'll be less worn, less tattered, less frayed. They'll be newer looking in the deck.
That's possible.
That's going to happen, but I don't feel like it's worth it. I mean, my Magic cards, you could tell my beta cards from my unlimited cards from my revised cards.
That's true.
And we just dealt with it. People didn't spend that much effort trying to figure out what was coming up in people's decks. I would, but I don't think anyone else will.
No. I mean,
plus, seriously, sleeves are a pain in the ass. How are you going to shuffle?
Yeah, shuffling is a huge pain in the ass when your cards are covered with, like, a piece of plastic. It's also, it's a lot harder to store the cards. You can't store them in the regular Old Dominion box.
There's a whole thread on Board Game Geek where they pointed out that if you sleeve them, they will not fit back, like, in the box.
Right, so it's like you got to find a kind of box that can hold sleeved cards. You know? And the thing is, sleeves were designed for games like Magic the Gathering, and they cut, remember like the Penny Arcade game came with those little plastic boxes? That's the kind of little, you know, it's a box designed to hold like one deck of like 60 cards, you know, for a game of Magic. That's the kind of box you can get that will hold sleeved cards. Good luck finding a box that'll hold a 1,000 sleeved Dominion cards.
One thing I'm amazed about, a lot of people are pointing out how they periodically replace the sleeves on their cardy games because they get so greasy and sticky. What kind of gamers are these? Seriously.
Wash your hands. Wash your hands. Jesus Christ.
There's no grease on our Puerto Rico set.
Yeah, I know. It's like, do I put plastic sleeves over like any other board game? I mean,
dude, Scott,
Agricola has a bunch of cards in it. You don't see me sleeving those.
People are suggesting the same sleeves that they're all using for their Agricola sets. Yeah.
Wow.
You know, we need to take a picture. We got to put sleeves on all those little brown men in Puerto Rico.
I mean, it's like, I put
take a picture of that.
Yeah, it's like I put sleeves on my comic books, right? But that's not because, you know, I'm like afraid of like anyone damaging them with a spill or something. It's because, have you seen a comic book, you know, from like 30 years ago? It's like unreadable. It turns yellow and it turns into dust. So, and the thing is, if I'm not going to read a comic book ever again, I just get rid of it. And if I'm going to keep it, it's because I want to read it, like, for the rest of my life, maybe. I don't really expect my Dominion set to last the rest of my life. You know, it's not really necessary. You know, it's like, it'll still be playable. I mean, my Magic cards are already from middle school, and they're still just fine. They're the same exact as they were, and they're not in any sleeves. Completely unnecessary.
Well, no, my Magic cards are all definitely worn out, the ones that I used a lot, and they obviously stand out as being worn out. They're not greasy.
They're slightly worn, but they're not...
No, they're worn enough to where it's obvious what set they're from. Like, it is kind of a problem.
I don't notice that.
And in
problem.
Fact, I in a couple of tournaments, I had to replace cards because they were worn enough to where the person I was playing against complained.
Uh-huh.
And as a result, I had to remove those cards from my deck or use proxy cards.
BS.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Of course, I also used to cheat. I would lick, I'd put them in sleeves, but I'd lick the sleeves of cards that comboed well together so they'd stick when I shuffled, because you can't shuffle sleeves.
Yeah. That's another thing, is that I think that sleeves actually can enable some forms of cheating, because you can, like, put things in the sleeves besides the cards, you know?
Like, we're playing Dominion, I'm like, blackjack, Yahtzee, what am I going to do?
You could put, like, a secret message and then, you know, pass it or something like that.
What? How's that going to help me? It's not Euchre.
I didn't mean in Dominion specifically. I meant in general.
What, in Magic? I tell my opponent, I'm going to beat you now.
Maybe in multiplayer Magic.
In multiplayer Magic, the goals are obvious. Yeah. You just want to beat the two, you know, opposite-colored people across from you.
The point is that I don't like sleeves.
I don't like sleeves either, but not for that reason.
It's an okay reason.
There are better ways to cheat than secret messages.
Secret messages are the ultimate cheating method.
Dominion's great, seriously, if you're a gamer at all. And also, if you're not super...
It's also the new hotness. Get it while it's still hot and people are playing it.
If you're not super into board games, I'd recommend Dominion as not necessarily a starter game, but one of the early games you buy after you get into board games.
Yeah, it's definitely like, you know, it's like you get your Settlers and your Carcassonne, like Dominion is next on the list after that.
It's also a great game if you're into games to get non-gamers in, because you can teach them how to play pretty quickly, and the game is so quick that you're not going to have people balking about sitting there for 4 hours.
Yeah, it's also great, you know, if you've got like a Magic the Gathering Pokemon card game type of person, and you want to bring them over to the German board games, like this is the transfer game, you know? Have them play Dominion, then the Settlers, if they're that kind of person. All right, I think that's about it.
I think that's about it. Now I want to go to bed, so.
Yep, let's go to bed.
This has been Geek Nights with Rim and Scott. Special thanks to DJ Pretzel for the opening music.
Be sure to visit our website at www.frontroadcrew.com, where you'll find show notes, links, our awesome forum, a link to our Frapper map, and links to all the RSS feeds.
We say feeds plural because Geek Nights airs 4 nights a week, covering 4 different brands of geekery. Mondays are science and technology. Tuesdays, we have video games, board games, and RPGs. Wednesdays are anime, manga, comic nights. And Thursdays are the catch-alls for various rants and tomfoolery.
You can send us feedback by email to geeknights@frontrowcrew.com. Or you can send audio feedback via audio. Just click the link that says send me an audio on the right side of our website.
If you like what you hear, you can catch the last 100 episodes in iTunes or in your favorite podcatcher. For the complete archives, visit the website, which has everything.
GeekNights is distributed under a Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial Share-Alike 2.5 license. This means you can do whatever you want with it, as long as you give us credit, don't make money, and share it in kind. GeekNights is recorded live with no studio and no audience. But unlike those other late shows, it's actually recorded at night.